Hi, I'm Jeff Davis. Strap yourselves in for this adventure on the Wine Road. This time we're traveling internationally. In January, the general manager of Bodega Garzón in Uruguay was in the area. Their flagship wines are Tanat and Albariño. When their PR firm reached out to me to see if I had interest in an interview, I found it intriguing since I had Napa winemaker Yannick Rousseau on the show in November talking about how he wants to familiarize the American wine drinker with Tanat. He also crafts a wonderful Colombard. So I reached out to the Frenchman to see if he'd be willing to join us. It was a resounding yes all around. So today, you can sit at the table with us for this interview and tasting as we discuss the state-of-the-art Bodega Garzón and the grape variety, Tanat. So why talk about a winery in Uruguay? Well, I'll tell you, if you haven't made your travel plans for this year, you might be inspired to visit. After looking at the website and hearing about the area and the country, I would love to go at some point. The general manager, Christian Wiley, was in NorCal because the owner of the winery, and many others, Alejandro Bulgaroni, was just about to open the Alejandro Bulgaroni Estate Winery in St. Helena. I haven't seen that winery yet, but Bodega Garzón is stunning and as state-of-the-art as a winery can get. I'll start the show by talking with Christian about the winery, then we'll bring in Yannick Rousseau, and they can discuss the Tanat variety. I read that one of Christian's passions is traveling the world, so I said, here you are in Northern California.
Yes, I am. Thank you very much, Jeff. Landed yesterday from the summer of Uruguay, which is world famous for its beaches. It's the peak of the high season. All the lovely, beautiful people are there spending their summer holidays. And there's a new, very important attraction in Punta del Este, which is Bodega Garzón, that opened about 10 months ago, and it has a fantastic restaurant, which is led by Francis Malman. So it's become a destination. The winery itself, it's an incredible undertaking. It's a project that took about six, seven years to build. It's still ongoing.
Yeah, did I read that Alejandro Bulgaroni found the Garzón region in 1999? So he's been building since then, and I understand the vision he had. He sure followed that to the extreme, didn't he?
Yeah. I mean, he's well financed, so he can follow his dreams. Garzón before Bulgaroni was basically a ghost town and kind of a dead municipality, and it runs on the northeast of the Punta del Este province of Maldonado, and it has the little town of Garzón, which is now active. It's back to life, but it's less than 200 people, so it's still tiny. It's like a hamlet. And then on the ocean front, there's another fisherman's village called José Ignacio, which today is like, you know, the hippie chic place to be in the world for New Year's, and there's a lot of art going on. There's a big right now. There's the JIF, the José Ignacio International Film Festival. There's a ton of things going on, and it's all about Garzón. It's a lifestyle. It's a little bit off the beaten path, but very much luxury of you know, bon vivants, connoisseurs that want to lay back and be off the radar. And there's amazing chefs, there's a lot of restaurants, and a lot of products being made there.
Yeah, sounds like a charming place. Yeah. Is it also rustic too, would you say?
Yeah, absolutely. It is rustic. It is a new vineyard growing area. And it's also, before that, it was developed for olive oil. So Mr. Bulgaroni has ventured into extra virgin olive oil with tremendous success, to the point where his Colinas de Garzón olive oil is today the New World's best olive oil, according to the Vinitaly panel, which is great. And now the wine, the vineyards, it's like a massive trial. It started in 2008, 2009, when Mr. Bulgaroni asked Alberto Antonini to come from Tuscany and, you know, tell him if he could make wine in this area. And long story short, Antonini figured out, you know, 10 miles from the Atlantic Ocean, facing south, direct south. So very cool breezes from the Atlantic. And then relative altitude between 100 and 200 meters high on this massive granite boulder, which the granite is meteorizing, so it makes this really good mineral soil called ballasto. And the combination of having cool breezes, the granitic soil, the same latitude as, if you like, Barossa Valley, Stellenbosch, Uco Valley and Maipo Valley. It's the same, like, ultra-premium wine belt, latitude 33.5 south. So you have the sunshine. And then what's interesting about Garzón is it has the rainfall of Bordeaux, which the other appellations in the south of southern hemisphere don't. So you have the sunshine, you have the ocean breeze, you have the granite, the minerality, but you have rainfall, on average about 1,000 millimeters.
Well, the winery itself is a great achievement in pursuing sustainability. It's state-of-the-art with its energy efficiency, using, I understand, 40% less energy than similar facilities. It's environmentally conscious, and we hear the word, you know, sustainability around here in Sonoma County quite a bit because we're pursuing 100% sustainability in our vineyards up here. Is Bodega Garzón a standout winery, or are other Uruguayan wineries also pursuing these thoughtful practices?
As far as sustainable construction, it's the first winery outside the U.S. that's pursuing the LEED certification, and it was built in a very sustainable way, meaning most of the construction materials are local, and the whole treatment of natural light, the efficiency of temperature control, and green roofs makes it pretty unique. There's more than 7,000 square meters, which would be 70,000 square feet of green roofs. The whole building is 200,000 square feet, and it's built on the rock, on the granite rock, which makes it fascinating, because as you walk inside, there's like rock paths when you can actually see the granite and understand the whole process. This is one of the gems when it comes to winemaking. It's the original formation of granite of before Pangea. So this rock is basically what cracked when South Africa separated from South America 5,000 million years ago. And it runs from, let's say, Angola to Nigeria and Uruguay to Brazil. So it's a very special granite that makes the wine mineral. But no, it's nothing. I haven't seen anything like it in the world. I've been around a little bit, and this project is amazing.
I don't know about you, but at this point, I was already inspired to jump on a plane to visit the town of Garzón and the winery, Bodega Garzón. At this point, I wanted to ask Christian about their winemaking practices. I read, much like the construction of the winery, their winemaking is also crafted more naturally, utilizing native yeast, untoasted barrels, and concrete vessels that allow the wine to have a greater expression of the characteristics of that variety. I asked how much of these practices are attributed to owner Alejandro and how much to their internationally trained winemaker Alberto Antonini.
Well, and the vision is Don Alejandro to decide to take this bold experiment or trial for the vineyards, and then also to hire someone like Alberto Antonini, who has a philosophy of winemaking as natural as possible. The combination and turns out to be Bodega Garzón, where there's 20 tulips, which would be like what people call eggs, the cement fermenters without epoxy. These are the improved version of the eggs at Cheval Blanc, and they're incredible because they're designed to take in the fruit of the vineyards. The way the vineyards are designed is also pretty unique. Instead of being New World big extensions, you look at it and it looks a little bit like a small Tuscany region, where there's 500 acres of vineyards, but there's more than 1,000 blocks. So it's like this patchwork is amazing. And some of the best blocks are designed So for the fruit goes into these tulips. So there's the jackets, the cooling jackets are built in the walls. They're the latest technology. So we ferment in the tulips, and then we age the wine in botis, in big fudres, with, as you mentioned, with no toast at all. So it's as little intervention as possible. The cement being the host for the microbiology and the microflora of the area, so the natural yeast and some other microorganisms. And in general, we try to interfere as little as possible.
Seem to be a, more of a common practice now. Even up here, they're trying to do that. Mm-hmm. I saw the photo of on your website of the winery's expansive vineyard blocks and the rolling hills and the ponds and lakes there. It is quite stunning. Uruguay is recognized as one of the most democratic and peaceful countries in South America. It's also strong economically, I understand, so I imagine tourism is doing quite well there.
Yes, it's mostly driven by summer tourism and the beaches. And part of the project of Garzón is to also develop the low season, the winter, as a destination for the winery, for gastronomy, wine education. There's projects to have a posada spa with the standards of Arrelé Chateau, at the same time as having a beach club in Punta del Este. Mr. Bulgaroni already built an amazing golf course right there, which is designed by the Phil Mickelson team and tweaked by Angel Cabrera. And you know, when you get time to play, it's fantastic. Yeah. So there's a big thing around Garzón. The winery includes this very exclusive club that it's a little bit of a billionaire's club, where you will be able to make your own wine in Garzón, but also in his properties in Tuscany or in Bordeaux or in Napa or in Mendoza. So it's quite a unique wine club. And of course, the members will have access to the golf and the beach and everything else. But it's definitely developing and growing at a very high level tourism destination.
Excellent. And similar to here, I imagine it's going to start picking up down there in the winter season, because it seems like there's more and more people around here in the winter season than there used to be. Getting back to the bodega, your flagship wines are Tanat and Albariño. We have the Albariño in front of us right now, and it is so rich in flavor, so wonderful. Tell me about some of the others that you're growing there.
As I mentioned, it's a massive trial, so there's a lot of different grape varieties. The main planted red is Tanat, but there's also Cabernet Franc, which we have a sample here. There's Marcellan, which is a Languedoc-Roussillon kind of a blend. It is a hybrid between Cabernet Franc and Grenache, which ripens a bit earlier, which is perfect for the climate in Uruguay. There's Petit Verdot, there's Pinot Noir, which I'm really impressed of how it's coming out. There's very, very little experimental Cabernet Sauvignon, and some other great varieties like Mourvèdre, Caladoc as well. And on whites, there's Sauvignon Blanc, there's Viognier, Pinot Grigio, of course, Albariño, some Petit Manseng. There's a bit of everything, which is part of the experiment.
How's the Pinot doing? Is it growing a little closer to the coast than the other varietals that you're talking about?
The whole estate, which... it's net 500 acres, but the way it's planted, it covers about 1,500 acres. There's lakes and palm trees. There's an amazing biodiversity. I mean, you have capybaras and ostriches and foxes and wild boars, everything in the same place. But it's relatively similar distance, this 10 miles. What the way it was planted is white wines are facing the ocean, facing south, so they are protected from the direct sunlight, southern hemisphere, and they're also exposed to the breeze. Pinot Noir is the same. Pinot Noir, the top Pinot Noirs are facing south, and they're hiding from the sun, and a little bit shallower soil, so on slopes. So that means you have maybe 1 foot of soil, which would be decomposed granite, and then the rock. So the It's still a young estate, but the roots are starting to feed from the granite, which is great.
It was at this point that we turned off the microphone and tasted through the wines he brought along. And as you'll hear, they were impressive.
Christian, we just had your Tannat, also your Cabernet Franc from 2015. The first Tannat was 2014, and your single vineyard Tannat, 2015. And my gosh, you guys have great control over the tannins and such a velvety feel on the mouth and tongue. And so, Antonini's doing a wonderful job.
Yeah, yes, he is. Combined with a team in Uruguay, there's a resident winemaker who is Uruguayan. I was born in a family of winemakers, and there's an excellent vineyard manager as well. It's cliche, but it's so true. The wines are made in the vineyard, and we think that these velvety tannins are a result of the Atlantic breeze, so cool climate, like some of those Syrahs in Chile that are really round and friendly, and then also the minerality of the soil and the drainage of the soil type help a lot to make this very round, easy to drink Tannat.
And for the richness of the wine, the price point is amazing, especially on the 14. I think Jeff, our guest here, said it could be a $300 bottle, but it's a fraction of that price.
Well, if you did a blind benchmark with Sonoma or Napa wines, you would definitely put it between $30 and $50 a bottle. It's in the market today, widely available in California at $15. So the value is massive, and it's getting a tremendous amount of attention and great write-ups. And this $15 bottle of Tannat is 95 points decanter, which is, you know, very, very strict and difficult magazine to get above 90. So yeah, it's tremendous value, and we really want, you know, consumers around to experiment and to get to know Tannat and Uruguay and this particular style of coastal Tannats close to Punta del Este.
And your single vineyard is also, it's still pretty young, but beautiful flavor to it and mouthfeel.
Single vineyard is a result of how the project is evolving. Now we have this state-of-the-art winery with all the bells and whistles, and the vineyard is a little bit more established. The roots are starting to tap into the granite. So all of a sudden, this thousands of parcels that we have, we're figuring out which are the best. And with lower yields, we're making the single vineyards. And that allows us to bring, it's a new range, that we made in 2015. Because we have the pluviometry or the rainfall of Bordeaux, Uruguay, and actually Maldonado or Garzón is very vintage specific. It's unlike Chile, which is very stable. This is very much like Bordeaux. 2015 was dry and a little bit warm, so an excellent vintage all across Uruguay. And we find that, I mean, it's a young estate, but it's already making top quality. So this range will come in to hit the market around $30, still incredible value. And we have the Tannat, still young, but already very accessible. And we'll have also an Alvarinho and a Pinot Noir, which is beautiful as well.
Yeah, it's 2015, as we said. But you said the vines, they're about 8 years old now?
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit of maturity there.
Yeah, starting. I mean, you can see in 14 already, in the 2014 vintage, that the wines are becoming balanced, and that's what's happening in the vineyard. The way we farm the vineyards is sustainable as it can be. A lot of labor, no chemicals whatsoever, and that's also part of the vision of Antonini, the philosophy. But we're all, I mean, I'm a Chilean winemaker trained also in UC Davis. And what we are tasting here for me is an incredible surprise. Such a young estate with an unknown, it's like a 21st century new discovered terroir. And all the factors come in and the wines are pleasantly surprising.
They no doubt have a bright, successful future ahead of them at Bodega Garçon. Now it's time to invite Yannick Rousseau into the discussion, the French-born Napa winemaker at Y. Rousseau Wines. Definitely a tasting room worth visiting. Tannat and Albarino are the primary varietals at Bodega Garçon. Yannick grew up near Tannat Vineyards in southwest France and is on a mission to get Americans to become more familiar with that variety, as well as his white French Calembour. So I reached out to him to see if he'd like to join in on the conversation. Much to our surprise, he said he had just recently tasted Bodega Garzón's Tannat alongside theirs. Crazy! So he jumped at the chance. Since he had done some research and he knows how well Tannat grows in France, I asked if he sees Uruguay as a good location to grow Tannat.
Well, I do believe so. I think the influence from the from the ocean is always good, because in California we don't have a lot of Tannat planted, but we have kind of a little bit two version of Tannat. You have the Tannat in Paso Robles, which is a warmer climate, and it's bigger in every way, so it can be kind of tannic, but also because it's so high in alcohol, rich and fruity, I do think that you lose a little bit of the personality of the Tannat. But if you look at your cooler area, and like Uruguay is a very long country, very narrow, and so like my Russian River or Alder Spring Vineyard is actually 10 miles away from the Pacific Ocean. And that, it does make a difference, I think, in the focus of the wine and the balance of the wine. Even though you have to be careful with the winemaking, like taking off the skin early on is if you don't do that, it's like you have to put the wine away, like we do in Madeira, or like we did. And so I do believe that Uruguay is probably, I haven't been there, I want to go there, but it's finding its identity variety. And I think in order to put Tannat on the map, having a country that can have that potential to produce good value wine, it's more difficult here because the cost of production in Napa and Sonoma is quite different. But yes, definitely.
Yeah, the growing styles, the vineyards that you choose and Christian's are very similar, and your wine is also rather smooth and velvety. And so I think I'm going to just step out a little bit here and let you guys chat a little bit. As you take over a little, do you have some questions for each other?
Very good. Yeah.
I think the reason why Tannat is the number one grown red grape in Uruguay is a little bit of survival of the fittest. It's a great variety that performs, with the different climates, and it's a red grape that you pick a lot earlier than Cabernet Sauvignon. So if you're a vigneron, if you're a grower, and in Uruguay you would lose your crop once every 5 years or every 10 years if you would. Striving to make a great Cabernet Sauvignon, but on the other hand, you always get good Tannat, good wine. You end up planting more and more Tannat, which is one of the reasons why this, country, the south of Uruguay, is in the same latitude as all the premium growing regions, but it has the rainfall of Bordeaux. So I think that's, I would like to ask Yannick if that could be one of the, the reasons for Tannat to perform so well in Uruguay in different climates.
Well, I think one of the reasons I make Tannat is because of my heritage, where I come from, learning from Alain Brumont. And when I started my winery in 2008, I'm very small. I make 3,000 cases total, so it's tiny compared to Garçon. But say that my mission is to put Tannat on the map a little bit, but it's because I believe Tannat has a potential. Tannat is a very generous variety. It gives you everything it has, the fruit, the tannin, the color. And I think younger sommelier generation in the U.S., they are so thirsty for this kind of new variety, new style, or maybe not new style completely, but they are so... They don't look at the critics. They don't care. Don't go and see them, oh, this wine, especially the sommeliers. They just want to like it. They want to see the different, distinctive. And I think there is a place for Tannat in the U.S. you know, we don't want to be pretentious and say we can try to do what Malbec did 15 years ago in the U.S., but there is the space to do that.
Some chefs, high-end, are actually saying that a good grass-fed steak, you know, that is not necessarily, you can't cut it with a spoon, but it's so tasty, actually goes better with tanat. Because it has, it's a bit more rustic, and it has a nice acidity and many more layers than a Malbec, which it's just pleasing because it's fruity, but it's not very long, and it doesn't really perform throughout the meal. A tanat will, you know, will the Uruguayans on a barbecue, they barbecue for 10 hours, and they keep you know, the fire going and making the coal and putting different cuts on the barbecue and just drinking tanat, and cleans your palate, and they keep going. Yeah. So I think it's definitely a very interesting wine for the sommes and for the chefs out there that, you know, someone, you want a big red or you want a different red, tanat is a very, very good alternative.
And I think the way you both have tamed the tannins down and gotten control of this variety is going to make it a lot more appealing to a larger audience.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a challenge. I mean, we, small winery or bigger winery, we still have to sell the wine to keep on going. And so the challenge is, I still want to be respectful of the tannat. I don't want to be overripe, jammy, plummy. I think you can take the tannat out of the Madiran region in a way, but it's difficult to take the tannins out of tannat. They will always be there, so we just have to manage them. But the acidity, the balance of acidity and tannic structure makes it, I agree, it's just more, it can stand up better to game or a good steak. Yeah. There's no question about it. So it's a big job of education.
It's not necessarily a massive red. I mean, a lot of more delicate palates really appreciate the quality as well.
At least the way you're making it. You say it can be. It can get out of control with its depth and fullness.
Yeah, and cool climate, good drainage. The mineral soils help a lot. And you see here, you compare the tanat from Russian River from Janik, which is 2014, and the 2015 single vineyard. And you can see different differences. They're both approachable tanats. They're not Chateau Montieu's that, you know, you just have to hide it for 10, 15 years to be able to get this drinkability. And it's one of the adjectives that I'm hearing a lot in UK. People like Oz Clark or Steven Spurrier or Jancis Robinson say, wow, you tame tanat. And it's, the drinkability is amazing. You don't even need food. You can enjoy the whole bottle, and that's what we want. We don't necessarily want, you know, the massive points, or we want people to enjoy one or maybe more bottles, and not just this glass that you don't know what to do with it. You can't even finish it. It's so massive. Looking to the expression of the place, and also the balance. And it's almost impossible to achieve harmony, but when you get the right concentration, the right alcohol, the right tannins, the right acidity, all of a sudden the wine is just, you know, beautiful.
This could certainly stand some aging as well, I'm sure. I mean, even though you say it's drinkable now, it can hold up for quite a while.
We don't know yet because it's starting. It's experimental. I work with tanat in another producer in Canelones in between the year 2000 and 2005. And we worked a lot with Patrick Ducournau with microoxygenation, as well as with Michel Roland, with, you know, he doesn't really adapt very much, but we tried a lot. We tried a lot. And yes, I mean, the acidity here, the structure, the concentration, this, without knowing, I would venture, this will be amazing in 20 years, no problem.
What kind of clones are you using? Do you have your own clone developed in Uruguay, or do you have clone? And the reason I'm asking is because the clone for the Russian River Tanat is a clone 1 from UC Davis. And this is the two clones from University of Montpellier. And this is a high elevation vineyard, 2,500 feet. This is kind of a valley floor vineyard. That's why there is a... So this is kind of more my introduction, Tana. This is a little more like, you know, your single vineyard, a little more denser. So do you use different clones on the Tanat?
I don't remember the names, the numbers, but they all, there's three different clones, and there's six or five different rootstocks. I can get you the information, but I'm pretty sure they're all French.
Yeah.
There's no UC Davis or anything like that.
Yeah.
No, no, they're all come from French nurseries. Definitely, there's something about having it on a slope versus having it on a shallow soil versus on a deep soil. And I think it's more to do with the drainage. If Tanat doesn't have good drainage, it doesn't have, you start getting this heavy style. In Uruguay, you can't really go very high. The highest point is 500 meters. Yeah, of the whole country.
Someone says it's pretty flat.
It's hilly. Yeah, yeah. But it's like England or Bordeaux. Like, I mean, it's the little hills. But, but where I come from in Chile, I mean, we have 5,000 meters.
Yeah.
Not that we grow grapes there, but you can't really go that high.
Well, there was a lot of information for you in that segment. I hope you find it interesting being a fly on the wall as two winemakers from two different parts of the world are talking about vineyards and winemaking. If you're interested in picking up some Tanat from today's guests, you can find Bodega Garzones at Bottle Barn here in Santa Rosa, if it's in stock, and I hear it might be available at Rayleigh's Grocery Store. And in Napa, it's available at Bounty Hunter Rare Wine and Spirits, downtown on 1st Street. Or wine.com is an easy way to order it and have it delivered. As far as Yannick's brand is concerned, his wine, Y. Rousseau Wines, can be enjoyed in their tasting room in South Napa on Enterprise Way, or Y, for Yannick, RousseauWines.com. If you get over to Napa from time to time, I encourage you to look them up. It's a great experience, and you can try his French Calambard. Their tasting room is nicely designed and very comfortable, and Yannick's tasting room manager, Olga, is a delight. You'll like her. Earlier, you heard Yannick's impression of Christian's Garzón Tanat. Now, Christian shares his impression of Yannick's California Tanat.
Well, I'm really happy to come across these wines and meeting Yannick. I think he's definitely making really good quality wines. They're both exceptional. I think the Mendocino terroir has an amazing angular style for the Tanat. I think this is what you want the consumers to taste, a really nice, approachable red wine where you have the structure and the backbone of the backbone of a cab, but it's got fruit and it's a little bit spicy like a Syrah.
Yeah.
So this is what people need to figure out and start tasting at a coming from Uruguay. Maybe it's even more approachable, being from Garzón. The tannin's a little sweeter, but I don't foresee any serious red wine drinker shying away from these wines ever.
That's the great thing about getting into wine and tasting, because you have such a variety and an open palate, and it's enjoyable to try different things, because sometimes a wine will go better in one instance and another one will go better in another setting.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's no such thing as the best wine. It's the best occasion or the best company. But it's there is something going on. There is a buzz about Tanat. And it's coming from different parts of the world, and I think the not just the Somms but also the millennials, which are now more than the baby boomers or whatever, or the X generations. I get lost with that. But the younger generation wants to experiment, travel, see the place, meet the person. They dig this people business. They like the subjectivity to it, and I think Tanat has a true, genuine story behind it, and you're going to see more and more consumers of good red wine getting behind the great variety.
And more travelers, I think, heading over to Uruguay.
Well, I'm telling you, they don't even imagine what they're going to find. I mean, I am biased. My heart belongs to a Uruguaya, but Garzón is I don't know. It's out there. It's world class. Absolutely.
Say, a real pleasure meeting you and getting to know you better, and I wish you great success. And I hope someday I can chat with you in Uruguay and,
yes, why not?
And see the place.
Absolutely. Right now, I mean, it's warm. I mean, yeah. My wife is on the beach. There's a beautiful people there, and it's a time to be down there. You know, January, it's summer for us.
As they called him in Arizona, I think I might become a snowbird
and
head to the warmer climate in the winter months. And Yannick, I greatly appreciate you joining us today.
Wes, thank you for reaching out to me, and I'm happy to spend a few minutes with you. Very nice to meet you both. You know, I'm small, but every time I have the opportunity, my mission is to put Tanat on the map. And I think maybe we can put our effort together and make it happen. So thank you for...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Muchas gracias.
Yannick Russo of Y. Russo Wines and Christian Wiley of Bodega Garzón. I sure enjoyed the wines they each brought to the interview, and you can't go wrong with either brand, so look them up and give them a try. Also, a final thank you to Sahar of La Dolce Vita Wine Lounge in Petaluma for hosting this gathering. It's a hot spot with a delicious wine list in the plaza south of the Boulevard 14 Theaters at 151 Petaluma Boulevard South. If you're listening to this on iTunes or another podcast provider, you can learn more about my show at onthewineroad.com and on Facebook as well. I'm on Instagram under the name JD Wineroad and on Twitter at JD Wineroad. Thanks for listening to this podcast of On the Wine Road. And now, a final word from Christian.
Well, how about Tanat tonight?
I'm Jeff Davis.